kids. It's time to get some SML podcast all up in that.
What's up, everybody? This is the SML Podcast. I am your host, Joe. Joining as usual, Cole, how are you doing?
I am fine and dandy.
Fine and dandy? That's a new answer.
I mean, the weather was good today. I don't hate anything. I'm just existing in moderately acceptable glee.
Moderately acceptable. And I hear the chicks.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we had to relight the heater tonight, so we had to move them from their corner. So they didn't get burnt by the stove. So they are they're a little closer to me, and they're a little louder because they're a little bigger.
So we're gonna hear peeping the whole show.
Yep, I'm very apologetic, except that I'm not. So
I'm really sorry, except go fuck yourself.
Yeah, basically.
Oh man, speaking of going fucking ourselves, Kris Huber's here. Kris, how are you doing?
That might be one of the most accurate introductions I've probably ever received.
How are you doing?
I am also existing right now.
In moderately acceptable glee or in...
Not acceptable- at all.
Oh, not in glee.
No.
Wow. Well, you know.
No, not at all. But I have been, I've been trying to play some Animal Crossing since it was so generously gifted to me.
What a good thing.
You got yourself some presents for this lockdown, didn't you?
I did.
Unbeknownst to you, I set up a fundraiser behind your back and got together the funds, and because you were down, I wanted to cheer you up, and we got you a Switch Lite and Animal Crossing.
And which I was reluctant. At first.
Yeah, you were super reluctant. You're like, don't do this to me. I'm like, dude, fucker, like, the money's here. It's happening. You can't turn this down.
I wasn't, fucking Beehive, really? I was not in the best of places, and did not feel comfortable accepting the generosity. I'm still very appreciative now, because it's definitely helped. Like, it's definitely helped. I also feel partially guilty because I haven't been putting like a shit ton of time into it, but like also mainly just because like I've been having to deal with like other issues and stuff first. So and the time that I have been spending, like I told you before we started, I've been spending at night because I'm a night owl and all the shit's closed. So
hey, I'm the same way. I'm gonna be up all night. I'll be fishing and bug catching all night. I'll probably be on the hunt for tarantulas.
I have fucked up every time. I've only seen one and I caught it. I've missed three.
Nice. You know what I'm really good at catching now? Wasps.
I don't remember. I haven't even tried, honestly. As soon as one drops, I just fucking run.
Do you want to know the secret? Hold your net out while you're shaking trees.
Most of the time when they drop, it's because I'm chopping one down. I'm not proficient enough to switch items quickly so that I don't, so I can actually catch them, you know.
I was going to say, if you're purposely shaking trees, shake them from the front with your net out. And as soon as it drops, your character looks at it. And if you're in front of the tree, mash the A button and you'll catch it right away. If you do it from the side, you'll just end up shaking the tree again. But I caught like four of them today.
Did I tell you that I fucked up on a money tree?
Ooh, how?
I accidentally covered the hole.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, you get a new one of those every day. So you have plenty of chances.
No bullshit. Like, it was the first night. And I knew exactly what was going on because everybody told me like that it was a thing. And then I was like, ooh, the hole. And then I dug it up. And then I was like, I was still learning the controls and I hit the wrong button.
Well, one of those shows up every day. So you have plenty of chances to make a money tree.
Yeah, I just made one and it was what reminded me to tell you that I fucked it up.
Cole, you need to get into Animal Crossing.
I know. I don't have it at all. The kids would probably enjoy it, but also I'm trying to make them go outside more instead of, like, digital outside. So it would probably not be ideal.
Eh, you never know.
I finally got reactions.
Did you?
Uh-huh.
There's so much stuff in Animal Crossing. Ashley and I, we've been building bridges and ramps, and I got to pay off my house. I got to try earning enough tonight so I could do that.
Just like in real life.
Yeah. And we pay in a fake currency called bells.
Also like real life.
Yeah, also like real life. Backed up by nothing.
Oh, currency. Oh, so how's your week been, Chris? How's things going for you?
Not spectacular. I don't want to be a Debbie Downer, so we don't have to talk about it. We could just talk about, like, Animal Crossing and other shit. I'm just trying to be, like, mindful of the people around me and not, like, dumping problems on them, so.
Well, we're here if you want to talk, but instead we could talk Vigigame news if you want.
Of course.
All right, well, games with gold and PlayStation Plus for April were finally officially unveiled this week. Games with gold was announced after the first games went free.
That sounds about right.
So Xbox was really on top of it this month. Xbox One.
To be
One,
fair, they've been working from home for weeks on end.
True.
So, you know, give them a little leeway.
Nope, none, zero.
None. Get fucked.
Fuck them.
Yeah.
Xbox One games with gold is Project Cars 2 and Knights of Pen and Paper bundle, so you're getting two games in one with that one.
That's not bad.
No. And then on Xbox 360, you're getting Fable Anniversary and Toy Box Turbos.
Okay.
So four solid games, nothing groundbreaking, but, you know, Fable Anniversary, that's a $40 game for free. Toy Box Turbos is like Micro Machines without the license. So it's solid games.
Yeah.
And then I'm not familiar with most of them, so.
Well, now you could get them free.
Yeah. Well, if I had gold, yeah. Because I stopped gold. My Game Pass thing, too, so. Yeah.
Chris, what are we going to do with you?
Nothing.
Next fundraiser is a year of ultimate for you.
No. No, I do appreciate you at least, like, popping this thing on your Nintendo thing, because I forgot that they were charging for internet and stuff now.
Yeah. Yeah, I switched over to a family plan, so now me, you, and Ashley are all online. I was trying to get my sister involved, but she already bought her year of online.
Right.
So, oh well. PlayStation Plus lineup for April, we already talked about this last week because it leaked early, but they confirmed that Dirt Rally 2.0 and Uncharted 4 are the games for April on PlayStation Plus.
Those are pretty big.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So PS Plus has a big month. Games with Gold has a solid month. I think everyone's a winner this time.
Nice.
Winner for everyone. And then Twitch Prime gave away five more free games this month. Mr. Sinister telling me to wave in chat. Hi, Mr. Sinister. And No Time is in chat. How's everyone doing tonight? Twitch Prime, the free games for April are Earthlock, Kathy Rain, A Detective is Born, Turok, Etherborn, and Light Matter.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think I know one of them. Did you say Earthlock, right?
Yeah, Earthlock and Turok, you should know.
Yeah, okay. I missed out on Turok. Yeah, so I know two of them.
I think Aki covered Kathy Rain.
Maybe.
I don't remember. We cover too many games.
Also true.
Now, Mr. Sinister, on your plate. Yeah.
Mr. Sinister's just trying to get me to wave in different ways now. Rage wave, honey. What's a honey wave?
I don't know.
That's where you cover yourself in honey.
But that would be
the dripping. The drippings of the honey create a more exaggerated wave.
That's scientific.
Yep. I mean, that's just logic, right?
Let's see. Game Pass. A couple of games are going to be leaving Game Pass later on this month with The Book of Unwritten Tales, Guacamelee Super Turbo Championship Edition, and Prey for the Xbox One. And then on 360, MX vs. ATV Reflex and Samurai Showdown 2 are leaving.
Okay. Samurai Showdown's solid. I actually really like that series.
Guacamelee's fantastic, too.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, sorry.
Bless you.
Thank you.
It's not all bad news, though, because two games joined Game Pass this week. April 1st, we got a totally reliable delivery service, which we'll be talking about later on in the show. And then April 2nd, NieR Automata. So that's a huge one joining
Game
Pass.
That is a big one that I never would have thought would hit Game Pass.
So yeah. I think totally accurate, or the moving thing. I think there was like a way to get it on PC for like cheap or free or something along the lines of that.
I think it's free on Epic.
Yeah.
Maybe that was it. Yeah.
PC Game Pass as well.
Yeah, it's free on the Epic Game Store for the first week, and it's on Game Pass. So, good stuff there. That's not the only NieR news, though, because Square Enix announced for the NieR 10th anniversary that NieR Replicant version 1.22474487139, that is the full title of the game, NieR Replicant version 1.22474487139, an upgraded version of the original game is in development for PS4, Steam, and hooray, Xbox One.
Whoa.
They're remembering us this time.
How nice of them.
I'm excited about that. I love the original NieR on 360, so I'm excited to see it getting a remake, and I'm excited that it is coming to Xbox and we don't have to wait for it.
Yes.
Now, if only NieR on the 360 were backward compatible.
Asking for too much.
Wish in one hand, shit in the other.
See which one fills up fastest.
Mr. Sinister, you play Xbox? No. Are you just now realizing that we're an Xbox show?
I mean, like, not all the time, right? Most of the time.
I mean, we're...
We cover everything.
Like
everything. Yeah.
We cover everything, but our heart belongs to Xbox. I can't hate PlayStation too much.
I have to do it because it pisses people off. That's the biggest reason I do that. I don't even fucking care. I just like to make people mad.
As like last episode, we covered Persona 5 Royal on PS4, and you're like, fuck PlayStation. Please don't hate us, Atlas. let's see. GameStop news. GameStop will be permanently closing over 300 stores this year.
I'm shocked.
Are you really?
Nope.
No. Not even the least bit. Like, come on, man. Like... Especially the bullshit that they pulled off with all this stuff going on. Like, come on now.
They're essential.
I mean, they're still technically open, too. It's just for curbside pickup only.
I mean, like, sort of okay. Like, but the logic that they were giving that, like, we're an essential business, like, no.
Not at all.
Like, no, you're not. And especially when they were like, oh, well, we supply items for people that work from home. It's like three things, like maybe the Stream Deck, a capture card, and like maybe you can make the argument for like a keyboard and a mouse.
Funko Pops, they're essential.
Yeah.
Apparently. Like, you know what I mean? Like, half the shit that's in there is not no. Like,
they sell Funko cereal there, so I guess that's essential.
It's food.
Food. They don't have enough to stock for that to, like, no.
No time saying that would have happened with or without all the shit going on. I agree with that. GameStop, they're not doing too good. They ended the fiscal year 2019 with a whopping $470 million loss.
Ouch.
Woof. Ugh. Yeah, I mean, I'm not surprised.
Their final quarter, they said, had an improvement, like a $21 million gain or something like that. But 470 on the year negative. Yeah,
that's bad news, Bears.
Walter Matthau.
Yeah, GameStop's not doing too good. So, which is where we bought your Switch. Because they're essential.
Because they're essential. Dude, you know what, Len? Again, wait, stupid question. What do I do with this ghost guy?
What ghost guy?
There's a ghost guy in
talk
my...
Talk to him. I don't know. This is fascinating. What's going on?
There's a ghost guy in my Animal Crossing.
Talk to him.
Hold on. I got to get up the ladder. I got to make a ladder.
No.
I'm just pushing him around. What do I do? Look. Oh, wait. There we go.
This is amazing.
He said, I eat a ghost, and then he turned into a wisp?
Hmm.
What?
Can you catch him with a net, maybe?
I'm speaking to him right now.
I have not seen that in my game yet. So you found something cool.
His name is Wisp. Nice to meet me.
Good stuff. Not good. Bad news. SGDQ 2020 has been postponed due to COVID-19. So they're just, you know, this goddamn virus is just taking everything we love.
Yeah.
I want my speed runs.
Not today.
No, Rupert is saying you got to find 5 pieces of something.
Yeah, his spirit. Hmm. Like, you scared his spirit away.
Interesting.
There's something good in it for me. There's 5 pieces, and I'll need to net them. Interesting. Well, I guess that's what I'm going to be doing in Animal Crossing now. Oh, I have Animal Crossing questions for you, Joe.
Let's get them out of the way. Let's hear them.
Okay, what's the deal with these fucking eggs?
Oh. Did you find the bunny in town?
Game and I know what that is.
did you find the bunny in town yet?
I did, but like, so like, why are there different types? There's like a sky one, a leaf one, and an earth one. Are they going to hatch Pokemon? Like,
there's like 6 different kind,
and
they're all for crafting.
So you need like specific ones to craft specific shit.
I believe so. Yes, you'll have to find the bunny, talk to him. He'll give you a recipe. And then I'm sure you could find other recipes through the day or through talking to them. I don't do much crafting in the game. Like, I'm not a huge fan of crafting systems in games. I can just barely tolerate it in Animal Crossing because I have to make fucking shovels and nets and fishing rods. I have to craft them. I would love to just get permanent tools and not have to worry about it anymore.
Well, can't you make golden tools?
I don't know. I don't have a recipe for them.
Well, no, wouldn't it be like that, like, when you get one of those holes, you just fucking dig the hole up and then just throw your tool in it?
I have no clue. I know that worked with the shovel on the very first Animal Crossing, but I don't know if they do that anymore.
I know I've played, like, I played the only other one that I ever played was the 3DS one. So, that was my, like, introduction to it. So, I can't say that I'm, like, I'm not a veteran of the series. I mean, literally, like, I was asking you everything as soon as I, like, launched the game.
Yeah.
I had, like, no idea what was going
on. And it's
on.
A new game, so there's new mechanics for everything. So things that worked in the past don't necessarily work this time around.
Right.
I enjoy what they're doing with the new Animal Crossing, though. I like the fact that they're slowly introducing everything in the game instead of just throwing everything at you right off the bat.
I'm indifferent about that because, like, I feel like I'm just fucking so far behind everybody now. Like, just so far behind. Like, I went over to my one buddy's island and I was just like, holy fuck. Like, it's just stuff. He already has all of his villagers. He had all the fruits. He's like, he had like bridges at like every single point of water that there was. Like,
do you know if he's been time traveling?
No, I don't believe so. Well, honestly, I don't know. Probably, maybe. I don't know.
Because I haven't done any time traveling yet. I
haven't either.
I like to do it legit.
Right, exactly. And I'm also the type of person where it's like, oh, I missed a certain thing to like finish the museum or something like that. Like, I don't care. Because the whole point is of a game like this is so that you're supposed to do it over the course of like...
a year.
Like, well, not only that, but like potentially further. Because if you missed shit, like... that's the whole appeal. It's like you're creating, it's sandboxy, you know, like.
Yeah. Light speed saying don't be a time traveler. I agree. Play it legit. Don't time travel. The only time traveling that I agree with is if you set your clock 12 hours different than real time, because I know
honestly, I was considering that because literally like the entire time that I've been playing this so far, I haven't been able to use the shop.
Yeah. So like I can understand people switching it from day to night and just leaving it that way, not constantly switching. Switch it once and leave it.
And then be done. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm good with that.
I might do that, honestly. I was thinking about it. Because I was like, well, if I keep it up at this rate, I'm literally never going to see the shop. Like, I'm just like.
Yeah, like Speed saying, if you time travel, you ruin the experience faster. I agree. It, yeah, it like takes some of the magic away. The game.
Right. It's like the whole purpose. Like, I don't know. Like, I did see like a couple. I believe that this is the reason why there's been so many updates is because like people like duping shit and like all that kind of stuff. Like,
probably. My sister wanted to try doing like duping a crown, and
it was it used to be super easy. I watched somebody do it like when the game released, and I was just like, geez, that's like, I can't believe they like didn't see that. Like,
people got a dupe. I don't know. Like, what are you getting in cheating at Animal Crossing?
Bells.
I guess. At least they
feel
like
bells, I guess.
I finally got a bagworm. I've had that in my Nook Miles Plus thing for like since the first day.
Shit. How many points did you get?
Yeah, 200.
Nah.
Oh, well. Great. And now I got the thing for popping balloons after I just popped 3.
Well, thankfully, with the whole egg thing going on, you're going to see a lot of them.
I figured.
Yeah, they fly around constantly. You'll see them in trees. You'll catch fish and instead you'll catch an egg. You'll hit rocks and eggs will pop out. They're everywhere, man.
Oh, I guess I just got a new recipe for the eggs by picking up an egg.
Now, there you go. You check your crafting book and see what kind of stuff you can make and what kind of eggs you need.
Yeah, but they're all dumb. like
it's all it's egg like, stuff.
Well, because I guess this looks like it's like an outfit. Like you put an egg on your head. Like it looks like you have an egg on your head and then you have like egg shoes. Like what? Like
now dumb. I want to see that.
It's dumb. Like,
yeah, not everything in the game is a winner. There's some weird stuff.
Like there's a bed. You make like a bed of eggs and some of them require, oh, at least, oh, now I see all the different types of eggs that are there. Okay. I get it.
Yeah. So some more news. Cole, I know you're excited about this, but Modern Warfare 2 Campaign Remastered. Surprise release this week, but only on PS4. Everyone else is getting it April 30th because Activision has to prove once again they're the shittiest company around.
I was both excited and really fucking pissed in the span of about 3 seconds.
Yeah.
Activision's really good at doing that now.
Yeah. I had pretty high hopes for them because they got their ass handed to them for keeping the Spec Ops wave mode out of Modern Warfare. So when Warzone launched and it was, oh yes, everything is same time. Here it is. Now I thought, oh, they've learned their lesson. They got their shit straight. And then they come out and they're like, we're going to piss on everybody just as fast as we can go. When will we run out of piss?
Never.
Fucking never, because we got an IV hooked up for water, too. That's Activision. That's what they sound like in my head. That's what I feel like every time they announce something for Call of Duty while they got PlayStation exclusivity. That's just where I'm at right now.
Yeah, I'm not even a Call of Duty fan, and I saw that news, and I'm like, fucking really? They're doing this shit again?
I just don't understand the value to it.
I mean, they had to write them a big-ass check. Like a big-ass check.
Rupert's saying if it was the other way around, you'd be gloating. You might.
No, I wouldn't. I'm not going to lie to you. I actually didn't like exclusivity when it was on the Xbox side either. I will say, when Xbox had exclusivity, it was slightly better in that it never affected like a full game release. It was usually just DLC maps. And 30 days, and we didn't have crossplay, so it didn't matter. So it was kind of moot. It was stupid, but it was still moot. And I was just like, I don't see the point to it. I don't know why I pay for it. It doesn't matter to me. Marketing, sure, but exclusivity is bullshit.
No.
But then when, for whatever reason, when PlayStation got exclusivity, they were just like, we're going to shit all over everybody. And it's been far, far worse. Still bullshit, still just as bullshit as it was when Xbox had it, but man, they really cranked it to 11 to be dick faces.
Yeah.
I don't see any value in multiplat games being exclusive at all. No. Yeah, there shouldn't be any exclusivity. I didn't think there should have been ever how many years, what was it, 10, 12 years ago when it originally came out? I don't think it should be now either.
No. And then Lightspeed saying the same with Final Fantasy VII and Square Enix, a whole year exclusive on PlayStation.
Yeah, I don't like it.
Everybody bitched when Tomb Raider happened on Xbox. Everybody bitched. Mm-hmm. Everybody.
Yep.
Final Fantasy VII exclusive on PlayStation, no one bats an eye.
Yeah. I don't see any value in keeping people from enjoying franchises if they don't have a certain branded box.
Yeah.
You know.
Square Enix thing, I can almost kind of like understand, just cuz like, I don't know, like, it's not like that was ever on anything else, right? Like,
what, Final Fantasy VII? I mean, it's on everything now.
Mm-hmm. Well, now. But it wasn't originally, right?
And originally, it was a PlayStation 1 game, though.
So. Yeah.
But now you could get Final Fantasy VII on pretty much every platform. It's on PC, it's on Switch, it's on Xbox.
Crystal Chronicles is another one that they've remastered that isn't going to be on Xbox.
Yeah, that one bothers me.
I don't think it's on... Is it on Nintendo?
Yes.
Oh. I don't fucking like playing the Switch.
Why?
Dude, I tell you what. Actually, I wanted to make this...
can't adjust to the controls.
I wanted to make this note of having the Switch Lite. Because before, when I had my other Switch, it was obviously like a regular one. I made this comment to you, Joe, and I didn't know that you had never... Like, you'd never actually like held one. But like, it feels... Handheld mode feels more comfortable on this than I remember the handheld mode on the regular Switch, if that makes any sense.
Well, that's because it's smaller and lighter, so it's just more comfortable.
Yeah, but
my
hands are bigger.
Yeah, true. You're just weird then. I don't know.
See, I don't like holding the Switch in handheld mode either, because it's heavy and it makes my wrists sore.
This feels, honestly, it feels so really comfortable. Like, it feels almost comparable to, like, like how I felt playing my 3DS.
Hmm. Oop. I know the girls want one. The one of the lights. They each want their own, and I'm too broke for that shit. So they can just go ahead and squash that dream right now.
Tell them to save their allowance.
Yeah, it'll take them a while, because I'm poor there, too. Although I did pay number one $20 for eating a pickled egg recently.
Why?
Because I know she hates pickled foods. And that was the price that it finally took to get her to eat it.
Hates pickled foods.
So you were just being an asshole.
Yeah.
Works for me.
I think they should try new foods, and sometimes you have to go the bribery route.
Oh, man. Let's see. Some more news. Rare confirmed that Sea of Thieves is coming to Steam.
Interesting. Yeah. Not mad about it. It's fine.
Players can wishlist it now, and a launch date will be announced soon. They also confirmed full crossplay between Steam, Windows 10, and Xbox One.
Good. Hell yeah. I mean, like, it runs really good through the Xbox app. Like, I never had an issue with it. I really enjoyed it. Honestly, I was considering trying to, like, mess around with it again if I get Game Pass again.
Well, if you decide to pick it up again, let me know. I'll do some sailing with you.
I like to sail, too.
Yeah, because cool. It's been a while. Like, I figured it might be cool to, like, go back and see, like, how it is now, considering I haven't, like, been in it in quite some time.
Lightspeed says, here comes the Steam cheaters.
Oh, there will always be somebody that wants to mod the fuck out of it. And...
I mean, I'm not going to lie. Like, Sea of Thieves with mods sounds incredible. Like,
it depends on the mod.
It really does. Like, that sounds... Amazing.
Yeah, I mean, if there's a mod that's like unlimited ammo or something like that, then that's problematic.
But yeah, but if it's like turn your boat into Nessie, I'm down with that.
The biggest thing that Sea of Thieves, if they could do, that would bring me back to it forever and ever and just let me lose 300-400 hours in it, it would be if they gave it a PvE server. I would get tired of dealing with griefers.
Yeah, if they should have like separate servers. Honestly, they should. I mean, I love the PvP aspect of it, but I mean, I know a lot of people that don't.
I don't like to deal with PvP. That's the thing that is starting to turn me off with Bless Unleashed is the forced PvP, and I just don't want to do it.
Yep.
There should be an option.
For all achievements, Lightspeed said, yes, please.
Yeah, like, the
achievements are bullshit.
I think any game that offers a PvP, but a PvE and PvP experiences, they should be able to, like, you should have an option for all three, where being that, like, one is, like, strictly, like, open PvP, mm-hmm. and then, well, three in that open PvP, it's always on, PvE only, or like opt in PvP when you want.
The biggest thing for me is that sometimes I just want to go fish.
Right.
And sometimes it can be a really relaxing game. Yeah. I just want to solve some riddles, you know? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then like you might not even have any shit on your boat because you just want to sit there and fish, but there will always be somebody who will find you and fuck your face off while you're sitting on a beach with your fishing pole. And then you're like, no, don't want to play the game anymore. Done now.
I gave the ghost his soul pieces back.
And what happened?
He's back to normal.
Yay.
Feels wonderful. And thinking of some type of clothing, I can get you something you don't have yet or something expensive. What's it going to be?
Oh, what are you going with?
I mean, I don't have anything, so I might just go expensive. Right? I mean, like,
that's what I would do.
That's the call. Like,
if it's ugly, you could always sell it and get some bells.
Yep, that's it. Something expensive. Okay, you got it. Oh, no. I'm not great at judging the value of items, so I'm not sure if this item is worth a lot. But here, have a facial mask. Great. Hold on. Let me look at it again. Yeah, facial mask. Where? That looks terrible.
Well, you're going to have to take a screenshot and send it to me.
Ugh, no.
So I could use it for the image on the show.
No. It looks like somebody just like bukkakied all over my face.
Now I really want to see it.
Right?
No, it's bad. You see my, maybe I will take a picture and I'll send it to you because then it would just be like my character with a fake facial and my custom Slayer shirt, and that's it.
Nice. So what other custom stuff did you make?
Nothing yet. I've been waiting until I like get some more options because there's like a more advanced one, right? Pro design.
I think so. Yeah, I haven't messed with that either. I'm not very creative, though. The most creative I get is doing this stupid show. Speaking of this stupid show.
I'm surprised that I can't, I have to wait until you get, the sisters, right? So that you could, like, do the whole, like, QR code scanny bit?
I don't know when that happened. Like, I've only had one of the sisters hanging out in my plaza. I don't have a house for them yet, or a building for them yet.
Okay. Like, that's what I'm, like, trying to, like, mainline to, just because, like, I want that.
Anyway, some more news. A lot of bad news. There's some bad news this week. OXM, the official Xbox magazine, has shut down.
Well, that's a shame.
Yeah. They shut down the American branch a couple years ago, and now the European branch is getting shut down, and the magazine completely is gone now.
Damn.
So, rip in peace, OXM. I will always remember you for your awesome demo discs back in the day. I miss demo discs.
I do too, honestly.
Those used to be awesome. More of a thing.
I mean, they barely even like put out demos anymore.
Yeah. That's one thing I'll give to PlayStation VR. They have demo discs.
Demos are full-fledged $60 games now.
And betas. Wasteland 3 has been delayed. This is got bumped back to August 28th. The Outer Worlds on the Switch got bumped to June 5th. Minecraft okay. Dungeons got bumped to May 26th.
No, I wanted to try that.
No, you're going to have to wait until May 26th now.
We'll have to get you some Game Pass.
Yeah. I'm surprised Minecraft Dungeons is only a $20 game.
Yeah.
I was legit expecting 40 or more for that.
It makes me question the depth of it.
Yeah.
But then again, like, regular Minecraft is only $25.
Yeah.
Right? Something like that.
I think it's just 20, isn't it?
On Windows 10, it was 40, I think.
I'm not sure.
Might be 30 or 40.
I paid like $3 on my phone.
Hmm.
And it's like the regular game.
Yeah.
It's the whole thing. And I didn't realize this. I have two different versions of it on my Switch.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, you have the Switch version and the Bedrock version, I guess?
Uh-huh.
Nice. Well, fire up the Bedrock version and earn yourself some Xbox achievements on the Switch.
I think that's the version that I was using because I had it tied to my... I had it tied to my... Minecraft's the game that I've probably purchased the most times because I had it on Xbox. I have it on Switch. I have it on computer twice. Because I had it through Mojang and then I bought it through like the Windows Store. What else did I have it on?
My Tiger iPad. R-Zone?
Yeah, my iPad.
Okay. So on Xbox 360, it's $20. And on Xbox One, the starter collection is $30 and the master collection is $50.
So $30.
And then I'm pretty sure that it was 30 on Windows 10. It won't show me because I own it. But I'm pretty sure it was 30 and like I got it on sale for like 10 or some shit like that.
Sales are good. The Xbox spring sale is apparently starting this weekend.
That I am excited about.
I think that those prices are going live pretty much as we're going live. So,
are there any Sims DLC sales?
I don't know if the DLC's on sale, but I saw that the game itself is only $10. But I only saw a handful of things.
That's not a good price.
The new one or the old one?
Sims 4 is like $4 all the time.
I don't think I've ever seen it that cheap. Origin has given it away two or three times.
I've been keeping an eye on it to try and get it like kind of cheap on PC, but I haven't seen it.
They gave it away on PC a couple of months ago.
The newest one?
Yes.
Huh.
Yeah. Like I was so mad because I bought it on sale for $6 on PC, and then like 2 weeks after I bought it, it was free, and I was like, "Son of a bitch." They took my $6 and ran.
You made the sacrifice.
I did. But, yeah, it's on sale all the time.
Rupier is my jam saying that the eShop and PlayStation Network sales are off the hook. That is absolutely true.
Yeah, when nobody has money.
Nintendo sales and Sony sales are usually really, really good. You can't go wrong with, like, 9-cent games on the Switch.
Yeah, that's wild. That's really wild.
See stuff for like 99% off. Like, how the fuck are they making money on this?
Right. I got a starving artist grant recently. Maybe nobody will notice if I use it on games instead of art supplies.
There you go. You got a
grant? I did. I got a grant.
What are you going to do with it? Anybody?
What am I? It was $100. So right now I'm just kind of sitting on it in case we need anything. Especially because I just coughed up for this monitor. So I need to like replenish our savings a little bit.
And the PC.
And the PC. Well, the PC come out of taxes, but the monitor I bought out of commissions. So I used some of my own work money for that. And somebody's got to pay the bills around here. Yeah. It'll help fuel creativity with games. That's what No Time said. And no, my art grant root beer was not from Bruce Wayne.
Oh, man. That'd be crazy if it was.
It would be nice because I think he gave me a little more than just $100. You know, I'm not looking a gift horse in the mouth over here. I'm not looking at the mouse either. But yeah, I was grateful to get it. Just gotta like sit on it and not spend it. Well, the at least it's easy to not spend it on art supplies that I don't absolutely need, because the people that make my art supplies are shut down too. They're in Seattle.
Oh, man.
So, no art supplies for me right now.
Well, I guess you could always run to Walmart and get shitty art supplies there.
Oh, my God. No, you cannot pay me enough to go back to Walmart art supplies. I was
Walmart supplies.
Graduating to real art supplies. I spent decades of my life thinking I was bad at watercolor. Have you
and
seen
it's
my
just
watercolor?
Shitty watercolor.
It was just really bad watercolor. And I thought I was bad at painting with it. I was like, I cannot figure this out. And then I finally broke down and bought a real set of watercolors, and I'm like, fuck, I was good with this all along. What the fuck is this?
Surprise. You had talent. You just also had shitty supplies.
I don't even give, they go, oh, it's student grade. And I'm like, no, I won't even give that to my 7-year-old to paint with. They gave her a watercolor assignment for her homeschooling stuff right now. And I was like, I ain't giving her no cheap-ass Crayola watercolors. Come here. We foster learning in this house, child. You're going to sit down with some core, and you're going to learn how to paint with ox gall.
I don't know what that is.
That's expensive stuff. And also, it's wrong because core doesn't make cores vegan. They don't use ox gall. But, but good watercolor usually has synthetic or real ox gall. That's why it moves in the water. Yeah, but like I said, stuff I use is vegan, except for they're black, and that's because it's made from charred cow bones.
Wow.
Like, literally, they're like, yes, all of our colors are vegan except one.
And what's in it? Charred bones.
And you're gonna pull out the top. You might as well shit on it while you're throwing it away.
I mean, if you're gonna make an exception, it might as well count.
Go big or go home.
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Go straight to the crematorium.
Speaking of going big or going home, The Last of Us 2 has also been delayed. No new release date was announced, but they said they're close to done. So hopefully it's this year. Yeah. A lot of delays.
Mm-hmm.
As shitty as this whole virus situation is, it does kind of lead to one positive in that during interviews, we now have a new question to ask. How did the virus affect your game?
That is true.
Content now.
Oh boy.
We are not original at all. But final bit of news that I have is that it was just announced Rogue Legacy 2 is coming.
Oh, hell yes. Fuck yes, dude. Yeah.
A lot of people thought it was an April Fool's joke, but they confirmed it is happening. No platforms or price have been announced that I've seen, but hopefully it comes to everything. Fingers crossed.
Dude, I don't care. That's fucking awesome, man. That was like one of my favorite. That game alone gave me faith in indie games again.
Wow,
dude, I love that game. It's so good, so good. Ugh.
What killed your faith in indie games?
Shower with your dad simulator. lots of them. actually,
don't shit your pants.
Oh yeah, that was a game.
Do you know who made that game?
Who?
The people who make Rogue Legacy.
Shut up. Seriously?
Swear to God, same company. Yeah. Cellar Door Games.
Well, I mean, then that's obviously a troll, but there's a lot of people that are making games that are not intended to be trolls.
There's still a lot of shitty indie games. We've covered a handful on this show.
I mean, they're cash grabs. And it's almost pretty blatant. And that's that's a bummer, you know? But Rogue Legacy, man. That's my jam.
Yeah, I'm excited for a new one. I love the first game. I still go back to it every now and then. Rogue Legacy and Quest of Dungeons are two games that I could still find myself going back to and firing up every now and then.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Solid games. And I still can't beat fucking Quest of Dungeons with the Necrodancer. The one achievement in that game I don't have.
Slay the Spire, I was doing really, really well with, I finally got all the unlocks for, like, all the classes and stuff. I've only been able to actually complete a game with one class.
Hmm. Oh, no.
Yeah. Like, every single time I'll get to, like, the final boss and then I'll just die. I've only been able to kill him once.
Damn.
Who did you beat him with?
The Warrior.
Really? See, I beat him with the Silent first.
Oh, the second one? Like the green guy? Okay, yeah. Yeah, because the poisons are awesome.
Yeah, if you can build up a really good poison deck, they're gone.
Well, that's what I was doing, but then like I would just like it's so hard to balance it to build a decent defense.
Yeah.
While also like just piling on like the poison stuff. It was really easy for the Warrior because I would just make it so that like when he was doing attacks, when he got like the leech kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, great. I could just keep myself healed constantly. And like, it was a lot easier to try and like, to maintain a decent HP.
The Warrior took me the longest. I beat it with the defect before I beat it with the Warrior.
Dang. I mean, honestly, that was the only game that was keeping me on Game Pass. Which is so much funnier because it's like out of all the games on Game Pass, like, you know, like, I mean, I was enjoying Horizon. But
I was gonna say, you realize there's like 200 games on Game Pass, right?
Yeah. Oh, I know. And I would sit and I honestly like, especially the PC Game Pass, they would update the game roster pretty frequently. I've been noticing. So like I was constantly like finding new stuff to play, but like, yeah, I just kept going back to Slay the Spire.
You should check out River Bond.
What's it about?
It's like a isometric voxel-based hack and slash game.
Okay,
it's pretty.
I'm
fun.
Definitely like Diablo-esque. You're saying ish.
Not necessarily. Like it's not a looter game.
Okay,
it's stage based. It's kind of like the stage progression of a Mega Man game,
like Gauntlet.
Kind of
like a Gauntlet Dark Legacy ish.
Yeah,
I can get behind that.
Yeah, you should check that one out. I really loved River Bond. That's one of the few games that they brought out DLC, and I went back and completed it again.
Damn.
Yeah. Cole, you remember that one. You were the one who reminded me that was one of my favorite games of the year.
Yeah. I do remember it. The girls had a really good time with it.
Yeah, I loved River Bond.
Well, I think I'm going to be pretty busy with Animal Crossing.
Yeah, you should be. I'll keep your ass busy. Ain't got shit else to do.
Well,
None of us do.
Yeah, I do want to try and attempt to be a little bit more productive. I think it's in my best interest to attempt to do so.
I think you should start doing more drum streams.
Yep.
It's tough, man, because like physically, I don't want to push myself too hard and then like be in a worse position. Because I'm still dealing with like my medical stuff, and yeah. I say I'm dealing with it. But I'm not really dealing with it because I'm just at home. So.
True.
Yeah. And now's not the time to be burdening the healthcare system. So, you know.
No.
Just gonna rat it out.
I don't know. I still think you should drum more. Do more drum streams.
It's
tough, bought
man.
A green screen. I mean, why the fuck not, right?
I did. And I still don't feel like I have it set it up proper. Set up properly. It's close. It's damn close. But it's tough, man. It really is. It's tough. I mean, I go a little too deep on it in the fact that like, anytime that I sit and try and play now, it only like reminds me that I don't have a job. Like, and I haven't gotten paid since the 6th of May. So, or March rather. So, and I haven't been able to like figure out anything as far as any kind of compensation or fucking any of that stuff. So. That's not always the best stress relief for me right now.
No. Oh, well, hopefully we gave you some stress relief coming on here and chatting with us. I'm not sure if there's anything else that you wanted to talk about before we move on to reviews, but.
I need suggestions to try and catch a freaking tarantula. There has to be a way that like, like I can't manage going through this game without being able to get one.
Like, hold the A button so that your net's out and ready. And
right,
when
and
you do
like
the
walk slow
creep,
right?
Yeah. And as soon as you see him rear up, stop.
Okay, but then
and then
he just
wait
like,
for him to go down and then inch a little closer. He'll rear up again, stop. He'll go down, inch a little closer. He'll rear up, stop, and just repeat just until you're close enough.
Dude, I can't believe I brought this up to talk about it because I'm looking at one right now.
You're looking at a tarantula?
Yes.
Oh my god.
Do it.
I do it. Hold on. All right, hold on. He's trying to hide behind a tree here.
Yeah, Rootbeer says move very, dude, very slowly.
I can't see him. He's behind a tree. Where'd he go? Oh, he's up that way. Okay. I wish I could. I want to be able to like stream this. He's up on his legs. I stopped. He's back down.
Inch
I made
closer.
It two steps. Two steps.
Yep.
One step.
It's a waiting game. It's a game of patience. If you want a tarantula.
Yeah, but eventually, like he just like jumps at you, doesn't he?
No.
I thought that's what he did.
If you do it right, he won't jump at you.
All right. I feel like I'm barely even getting close to him.
You're like three screens away from him right now.
Dude, I'm so far right now.
Urupir says to find a tarantula island. That's a good one. You could visit different islands, and
like
one of them is just...
How far you're netted? No, oh, no. I got him.
You got him? Ugh. Sweet.
Ugh. Ugh. I mean, I should donate the first one, right?
Of course.
Yeah. Like, that's, you know, science.
It's the first thing you always do. Donate the first one.
I can't wait to give this owl a tarantula. He freaks
fucking
the
blathers.
Fuck out every single time. Like, so good. I'm literally dropping it off right now.
No, you got your tarantula. That seems like a good point to let you get going.
Yeah, timing of that was actually pretty clutch.
Good stuff. Good stuff.
I appreciate the distraction, guys.
Well, thank you for being here. It's always good having you on. You are always welcome here. This is your home.
Mm-hmm.
You helped found this place. So anytime you want, come chat with us. Come hang out with us.
Thanks, guys.
We like when you're here.
Yes.
Thank you, Joe.
So do you have any final words before we let you go?
I love you. You're a great friend, and I appreciate you very much.
Love you too, buddy.
All right. See you guys.
Peace out.
Bye.
All right. Rootbeer, now find a scorpion. Oh, I haven't seen a scorpion yet. I thought those weren't out until summer months, but... Well, anything else you wanted to talk about, or are you ready to dive into reviews?
I'm ready. Let's bust this out.
All right, we got a handful to talk about tonight. First one to talk about is called Children of the Zodiarcs, developed by Cardboard Utopia, published by Plug-In Digital, released March 27th on Xbox One and Switch for $17.99. Children of the Zodiarcs is a story-driven tactical RPG set in the fantasy realm of Lumis, a world divided by affluence and poverty. Take control of Nami and her fellow outcasts, utilizing a brand new deck and dice-based combat system to strike a blow to the noble lords and ladies' unquenchable thirst for profit. Cole, tell us about Children of the Zodiarcs.
That's incredibly topical for right now. I have to be 100% upfront honest. I am playing Children of the Zodiarcs right now, even though I finished my review yesterday. I have played it several times since, and that's a good sign.
Are you going to have to delete this one?
Maybe.
A sign of a good game is when we have to delete it.
Yeah, pretty much. That's how you know I like your game a little too much. So Children of the Zodiarcs, you start off with Nami and crew, and your goal is to get through each mission and survive the onslaught and combat, obviously. I'm also trying to like not lace in any spoilers, so which I could easily do like right away and not even realize I've done it, because that's how I roll. So if you've played a tactical turn-based strategy game, Mutineer Zero, XCOM, anything where your levels are laid out like a grid, you're already halfway there. If you've played anything like Slay the Spire or A Long Way Down, you're already just like knocking it out of the park on knowing how to play Children of the Zodiarcs. Are we suddenly realizing why I like this so much now? There is the element of dice rolls that comes in when you are in a combat scenario. But I'll get to that in a second. when combat occurs, the enemies will come out onto the level. You can move your characters. One time you get to choose who you're going to move and when. You're not locked into any kind of, you know, rules as to it's this player or this character's turn to move and they can't do anything else until you move that character. No, you have the freedom of deciding I'm going to move, say I'm going to move Nami first. And, but now once you move a character, it's kind of like chess. Once you put your finger on one of them, you can't, you know, move on to anybody else until you've exhausted it, you know? So say I choose Nami, then I can move her within her range. You have to use your action to move, and then you have to use a card action. So you can either use one of your cards, you can draw more cards if you don't have anything that you want, or you can set them to guard. That might be my biggest complaint, is that guard is built in with the card actions. So if you decide to attack, you have no defense mechanism whatsoever. You're just left standing out in the open every time. You can use your cards. Some of them will be healing. Some of them are attack. Some of them are defense mechanisms. You do get new cards to add into your deck. So there is some deck building, although it is not as in-depth as, say, Slay the Spire, where you have a choice over the cards that you get. The cards that you get are unlocked naturally through level progression instead. So once you hit, you know, the XP goal, you level up, you get a card. You don't get any say in what that card is, though. You do get to choose if you put it in your deck or not, but that's the extent of it. You have to have at least 18 cards in your deck. You cannot go any lower than that. So again, you can't do like a min-max where you've got two or three types of cards and you're really pushing a certain type of build. You have to have a little more variety. Once you choose a card, for example, and you do your action, then you have to roll dice. You can level up and unlock extra dice slots, but you start off with some basics and they'll have the ability to roll a shard, which may increase your attack. You can get a shield, which of course either, you know, helps lower the counterattack, because the enemy will always counterattack you unless you do a ranged attack. And depending on if it's a ranged enemy, they might counterattack you anyway. But ranged attacks are your best means for limiting counters. But if you roll a shield, the amount of HP you lose in a counterattack is lowered a little bit. You do get the option to reroll if you get dice that you don't like, but you can't reroll the whole thing. You'll have to, initially you get two rerolls, and you can choose two dice that you want to reroll, but you're stuck with everything else. So be very careful with what you're rerolling. Sometimes you may get a curse and have to roll an extra curse die, for example, but even those are not like instant suck, you know. you can waste one of your rerolls if you're going to take damage, for example, from your own attack. Then you can reroll a cursed die and hope that it lands on a blank side so that you don't take damage. The odds of that are low. You're going to get fucked. if you get hit with a cursed die, it just sucks to be you.
Nice.
even though the deck building feels kind of minimal, it's still sufficient enough that you have enough choices when you're in a battle. If you set up your card deck, you can go, yeah, I have a little control over how this is going to play out. It didn't take me very long to get one of my characters. I'm not going to say her name. I don't want to spoil anything. But it didn't take long. Like, as soon as one of the characters joined my party, I immediately had her overpowered. I was just like, watch this.
Oh, God.
And she, while Nami's running around throwing her knives for like 5 hit points, this other character's like, watch me hit them for 40.
Oh, jeez.
Everybody's dead. One hit kill. She'll take a whole group. She does not give a fuck.
Easy mode.
Yeah, basically. So the levels play out as your mission. And then once you get to the end of the mission, sometimes you just need to clear out a certain amount of enemies that are in your path and clear the level. Sometimes you need to actually get to a certain exit point in the level. So as long as you continue to fight and not go to that exit, more enemies will keep coming after you, which is great for, you know, boosting XP and stuff. But eventually you're like, okay, if I linger too much longer, I'm going to die. And that's bad. You don't necessarily lose just because one of your characters dies. Each mission has different win circumstances, and they also have specific defeat circumstances. So you can have all but one of your characters die, but as long as that one exists and gets to the exit, for example, you win. So it's all the same as if you got everybody there. Which is nice, because some of the battles are really fucking hard. And everybody's gonna die, and you're like, well, let's just hope this one can book it two squares. It's right there. Run. But sometimes it will be a little more specific, or it'll be like, this specific character can't die. If that character dies, get fucked. Which makes it a lot harder. Sometimes you have multiple battles going on at once, where you have the mission broken into different segments, and you'll need to be fighting with one subset of characters in one area, and in another area you have a different subset of characters fighting a different group of enemies. That's challenging when you're trying to keep up with both fights. Although it is nice that even when it's in that kind of setup, you control everybody on your own accord. So if you're kind of stuck with where you want to move people in one fight, go deal with the other one for a minute and then look back at the other one with fresh eyes. And then you're like, never mind, I know where to go now. Everybody's going to die. There, guys, not mine. I don't die. That never happened.
Never.
Never. Haven't lost the one yet. That's bullshit, but we don't want to talk about it. So, like I said, it plays out as acts with the different levels, each being a mission. So in between each mission, you get a world map, if you will, but it just kind of like lays out the path that your characters have gone on. Think of it as a Candy Crush map. You can go back to the levels that you've already eaten, but you can't go forward until you unlock them. Mm. But one thing that is interesting is that on that map, there are I can't remember if it's a moment of reflection, I think it is, or a moment of thought. But basically, like, you can get little interactive scenes between the characters that you wouldn't, you know, get unless you go back to those moments. Which is nice to give you a little more detail in the story. Visually, I think the game is stinking beautiful. I did not expect it to look that pretty. It's definitely got like a painterly aesthetic to it as far as like characters go. You do have the whole 3D world that your levels take place in. And then there are 3D character models, which aren't as nice as like the portraiture type of artwork that's been done for the dialogue boxes. And some of the animated cutscenes, those are far nicer looking to me, but it makes sense that, you know, everything takes place on a 3D plane. It's almost like playing chess, like I said before. But it is still really well done, still really pretty. Even if the portraiture is probably more my speed. Yeah. that's pretty much the long and short of it. It's a unique blend of deck building, and I didn't, apart from just kind of being frustrated that you don't have any control over whether you can guard versus make an attack. Like, it's just, if you guard, you're done for. You don't get to do anything else until your next turn. That's just more of a minor complaint for me. I would like it a little better if maybe there had been some kind of like action point system where you could do multiple things. Sometimes you can luck out and there are cards that will give you one free action, which is nice. Those are handy because then you can attack and guard, but they're, you know, scarce. They're meant to be. So it's a little more frustrating, and that's just a personal thing. It's not an actual gripe as far as the game goes. That's just me being a whiny bitch and wanting to be able to guard.
Well, then, as it stands, for $18, what do you think?
That is such a good price. This is such a good game. It plays really well. It's really pretty. I don't have any major complaints. I'm happy with giving it a buy it.
Awesome.
Yeah, I'm going to play it some more.
I got to pick this one up myself. This is one of those games where I'm sad we only got one code.
Yeah, you should be, because it's a good one. It is a good one.
But it's only $18, so I will pick it up myself. I have no problem with that.
Do it!
All right, next game to talk about is called Totally Reliable Delivery Service, developed by We're 5 Games, published by tinyBuild, released April 1st on Xbox One, Switch, PS4, and PC for $14.99, available on Xbox Game Pass, and it is free on the Epic Game Store for the first week. Buckle up your back brace and fire up the delivery truck. It's time to deliver. Join up to three of your friends and haphazardly get the job done in an interactive sandbox world. Delivery attempted. That's a totally reliable delivery service guarantee. Cole, tell us about this one.
I have to be perfectly honest. These kind of physics games are a little shady as far as me liking them goes. I didn't enjoy Human Fall Flat. I didn't overwhelmingly enjoy Gang Beasts. I was like, it's a thing. But for whatever reason, I am definitely into Totally Reliable Delivery Simulator. I can't even say it properly. I don't know why I'm into it, but here I am. I am happy as a pig in mud. I played it co-op online in the same house, but we were on two different Xboxes with number one. And it was just giggles and screaming and carrying on like idiots the whole time.
That's the sign of a good game.
That is the sign of a good game. And then like number two and number three were staring over our shoulders respectively. And I'm like, I get it. You guys want to play it because it looks goofy. You're going to have to wait a day or so till I get done with all my review shit. So I will not be surprised if tomorrow they're like, are you done with everything? Can we play it? Because here we are. Like I said, it's very similar to Human Fall Flat. You have the jiggly physics of a chubby little delivery worker. You can completely customize them. Although number one was pissed that pink hair is not an option.
Uh-oh.
That's something to take into consideration.
So that's a deny it rating right there.
We need pink hair and we need it now. Although I will say they had orangish red and that's my color. So I was fine. But number one was very pissed. She literally screamed. We didn't have headsets on. We just had the door open because the two rooms are close to each other. And I could just hear from the other room go, they don't have pink hair. And she was so mad. Like, she bitched
Mom, this is bullshit.
I don't even want to play this game anymore. Where's the pink hair? So, you know, 16-year-old girls, they do what they do. But she did play it with me. And then it devolved into utter chaos immediately. So the whole point is there are little mailboxes all over this island. This is a fucking huge map, for the record. And you go up to it the best you can. And you grab a hold of the lever. Again, the best you can. You use left trigger for your left arm, right trigger for your right arm. If you use the bumpers instead of the triggers, then it holds the arms up, which is handy. Root beer is my jam. Ask, can you play split screen? And the answer is yes, you can.
That's good.
We did not because we wanted to try out the online, obviously, yeah, for the review. So I assume if you're playing split screen, though, there may be a limit to how far away you can get. Don't quote me on that. I cannot promise or, you know, prove or deny because I didn't test it out.
Yeah, I'm quoting you on that.
Yeah, fuck. Completely lost my train of thought there. You go to the little delivery box, pull the lever the best you can, and a package will appear. Sometimes it's a box, good old fashioned cardboard box. And sometimes it will be a flammable barrel. And sometimes it will be a tank, and sometimes it will be a bomb in a bag. Don't know what their processing is for this post office, but you need to be a little more careful with what you're letting into your boxes.
You need a better screening process.
You have to deliver it no matter what it is, and you got to do it the best way you can. But the more you throw that box around, if you drag it behind you, if you throw it into the back of a truck, it's going to take damage. The goal is to get it from A to B as carefully as you can. She's not going to be very careful, but as carefully as you can. The better shape the box or the package or whatever you're sending is in when it gets where it's going, the higher your rating for that delivery will be. So then you get a bonus. It will do like bronze, silver, and gold. So if you deliver something and it's only like 20% integrity, you're getting a bronze. This is the way the cookie crumbles. You're not getting as good of a tip. There came a point when we were playing the game where I was literally just taking packages and running and dragging them behind me to see if I could get it to the delivery spot before it hit zero. And the whole time, number one is like driving along in the little truck behind me, blowing the horn, going, "Get to stop it! We're not going to get anything for that one! Mom, put it in the bag!" And I'm like, "Nope, I'm going to make it. I'm hoofing it." And I was just running. Get it there and it'd be like 3%. And I'd be so proud of myself because at least I got it there. Just because you put something in a vehicle, on a forklift, even in a helicopter or on the boat, doesn't mean it's going to get there well, because that shit will just fly right off sometimes. It's physics, and that's just what's meant to happen. If I had any one complaint about the game, though, it was that when you have an uphill area, obviously downhill counts as well, but whenever you have an area that's on an incline, you clip through it very bad, a lot. And there were times where we would just flat out get stuck as if we'd like walked into the center of a mountain and had a boulder crush us. We weren't going anywhere. And we were standing on a perfectly fine middle of the road incline. And it was like, no, you're done for. You can't walk. And you would be forced to respawn. There's no penalty for respawning, thankfully, because one time I got myself stuck in a delivery box.
Proud of you.
I was like, I'm going to slam dunk it. And I jumped and I threw the box in. And when it come up and closed in around the delivery, it closed in on me too. And then I couldn't get out. And the best part was like, all you could see were my fingertips poked out at the top of the box. And everyone's like, "Mom, get out." I'm like, "I can't."
You broke the game.
It was horrible and it was hilarious, but I just respawned and it spawns you back to the nearest delivery box. See, you're fine. Everything's fine. Other than that, the only other time we had an issue was there was one point where I was 110% standing beside number one. And she's like, "I can't see you. Where'd you go? Why does it show that you're all the way on the other side of the island?" And I'm like, "I don't know, because I'm literally right here." So she leaves her room, comes into the living room, looks at my TV, then goes back and looks at her TV. And she goes, no, you're not there." And I don't know what happened. And then magically I jumped in the truck and she's like, "Oh, I see you again." And it, it was fine.
Weird.
I don't know what we did to it, but we kind of broke it. That's fine.
Nothing new with you. You break everything.
You know, I think that just the nature of a game like this allows for it to be broken. Everything else is just going haywire anyway. At one point, I put a thing of an exploding barrel in a Ferris wheel and just had it spinning as fast as I could just to see what would happen. That's the best part of the game, was like you're playing around with it. Who cares if you actually deliver anything? The best part's just seeing what you can break.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, $15 on this one. What do you think of totally reliable delivery service?
I give it an absolute buy it. It's so fucking fun. I think if you're doing it alone, it could probably wear itself out pretty quickly. But if you've got somebody else to play with, or you can find a game online to play with, you're going to have a lot more fun.
Nice. We got to play this one. This sounds like me and you would have a good time together.
And since it's on Game Pass, everybody should be able to find somebody to play with.
And free on the Epic Store. So if you also have PC, pick it up on Epic. So first week free. All right, next game to talk about is called HyperParasite, developed by Troglobytes Games, published by Troglobytes Games and Houndpick Games. Released April 3rd on Xbox One and Switch and PS4 for $14.99. A roguelite twin-stick shooter brawler that never plays the same twice. Collect and control 60 different characters as the body-snatching alien parasite with a grudge against humanity. Fight to the top of the food chain, possess the president, push the big red button, and one-up the human race. And shout out to Awesome Prime, who just dropped 20 bits in chat. Prime, thank you so much. Norg, take it away.
Drop it, bitch!
Nicole, tell us about HyperParasite.
So, HyperParasite is an 80s-themed roguelike twin-stick shooter where you are literally playing as a blob of parasitic alien goo. You have invaded planet, and now you need to find a host and destroy fucking everything. Yes!
This sounds fun.
This is a lot of fun. I was a little questionable on it. Twin stick and roguelite are my shit, and I'm very picky about that shit. It didn't take long for my brain to start making connections between HyperParasite and Helmet. They play very similar, and that with Helmet, you have to find different bodies for the brain to inhabit. So, and different bodies have different perks. So much like that in HyperParasite, you can find and take over. I want to say you can take over any enemy that's shooting at you. That's not 100% true. Some of them are locked initially. You have to, kill them first. You have a handful that you can choose from the start. Like the paper girl, you can take her and then throw papers, newspapers, at the enemies. You can take over hobos and ram people with their shopping carts. You can take over the police, and then you have a pistol to shoot with. Each different body type that you can take over has a regular ability and then like a supercharged ability. So that's nice. You have a little bit of a variation in gunplay there. Once you kill, I'm not sure what the criteria for it is. I don't know if you have to, I know it's not just you kill it once, because there were plenty of different enemy types that I killed once and they didn't drop their brains. However, occasionally an enemy type will drop its brain. When you kill it, you can then collect that brain. And the next time you're in a shop, you can deposit the brain. That unlocks that enemy type for you in future runs. So once you have the brain and have it deposited, you can go ahead and use the parasite's ability to take over that body whenever you encounter it in the current run. But you also have a chance of starting with it in your next run, which is handy. Although I always seem to get the paper girl. I don't know. Maybe it's just shitting on me. And it's like, here's the paper girl every time. Fuck you. Like the one time I started out with the cop, I was so used to having the paper girl that I hit a barrel and blew myself up. if your host body is destroyed, you do have some time as the parasite to, you know, look for another body. And you can also shoot parasitic goo as a weapon, but you don't have, it's like helmet again, you don't have that protection of having the host, so you're weaker, and one hit is all it will take that will do you in most times. Sometimes you might
Headlander as well, so
similar. I guess I don't make the comparison to Headlander because Headlander is 2D and side scrolling.
I'm just talking about like the possession mechanic,
but
switch bodies and stuff.
That I can see the similarity there. Different host bodies have different like hit points, and I already mentioned that they have different weapon types and stuff. But it breaks up the gunplay, the monotony of gunplay without you actually having to pick up different weapons. You can take over and drop a host body dynamically. So if you have one and you're like, no, I want that one instead, you can leave the one you're in and go to the other. The game is hard. Most games in this genre are. And the game knows that it's hard to the point that it literally will tell you in the tutorial, learn to evade. And if you don't come bitching at us that it's hard. That is exactly how it puts that out for you.
Nice.
They don't want to hear you bitching that it's hard because they done told you it was going to be hard. And evading is incredibly important. You're not getting anywhere if you're getting popped immediately. It's one of those games that's like, it's hardcore, but it's goofy. And so it doesn't take itself too seriously, and you can just have a good time joking at it. Even though it's a struggle, you don't mind it because you find the humor in it. It's procedurally generated. So, every time it's a roguelike, it's every time you play it, it's going to be different. You have different abilities that you can pick up. Sometimes you will find goo in different rooms where you can get upgrades. You get to choose between three of them. You can go to the shop. I got tickled. Sometimes you come into the shop and you're customer of the month. And so shit's cheaper. But I don't know. I'm bad at the game and I was always broke. I can never afford anything. I hesitate to say it's pretty. It's not pretty, but it's well done visually. Although at times there's a good map, so you don't feel overwhelmed by the fact that some of the areas kind of look repetitive. Especially if you're dying a lot early on and you don't get to see much more than the first level for a while. but that's a me problem and not a game problem.
Yeah. Well, as it stands, $15 on this one. What do you think?
It's a pretty standard price for a twin stick roguelike. And I think that, I think HyperParasite holds up to it and is perfectly fine at a $15 price point. I say buy it.
Awesome. Yeah. Quick shout out to Vertically Impaired. Just subbed to us for 25 months in a row.
You poor sap.
25.
Is there not anything else you can think to do with $4.99?
I mean, there's a lot of good stuff you could do with $4.99. Subscribing to us is probably the worst thing you could do.
Yeah. But thank you. Anyway.
Thank you, Tony. Always good seeing you in chat. Thank you for being here. And thank you for the sub. Let's see. Next game to talk about is called Save Your Nuts, developed and published by Triple Scale Games, released it's coming out April 16th on Xbox One, Switch, and Steam for $14.99. Go nuts in this insane 1-8 player chaotic arena party game. Put your cooperation skills to the test over intense physics-based battles, mixing casual offline modes and competitive online matches. Cole, what is Save Your Nuts? Besides a great game title.
A whole lot of chaos. you're playing as squirrels. You can play against bots if you don't have seven people to play with you. Also, you shouldn't be playing with seven people because we're fucking quarantined right now and you're not supposed to have that many people around you. So
very, very true. But we got to do another shout out. No time for games. 275 biddies, George.
Oh, dropping bits.
I love that sound clip.
So good.
We need wet pancakes, George.
Wet pancakes.
There we go. Wet pancakes. Anyway, save your nuts.
What did I say about it already? Oh, you it's shouldn't chaotic. Be playing with eight people at one time right now.
Unless it's online.
But if you don't have eight friends to play with, if you can't find eight other people to play with online, which shouldn't be that difficult. I played online with number one against bots. Again, we were just playing it alone. It was a weird hour. I wasn't going to try to find people.
Could have messaged me.
Yeah, I wasn't even thinking about it. I was like, go in there and download this so you can help me with a review. Can't do that next week because then they're back to homeschooling shit again. So I'd take advantage and get all the local multiplayer shit out of the way while we're on spring break. But you can play, like I said, there's bot options. You get to choose the difficulty of your bots. I don't think it fucking matters. I set them to easy and they still kick my ass.
So, yeah, I set my bots to hard and I set the opponents to easy and it was still like a close match.
I set my bots to unfair and set theirs to easy.
I didn't know there was an unfair.
I lost. What the fuck?
Oh, Prime dropping 10 more biddies.
Dropping bits!
Thank you, Prime. You are a good bean indeed.
Yes. So, there are three game modes. One, I literally had the words in my head. I know one of them is battle, and I just lost the other two.
The hell are they? There's the battle one, there's
I know what you the do, collect but what the were nuts. They called?
I don't remember the names of them.
Anyway, and
we should write this stuff down. We're bad reviewers.
Look, I've had a week and I didn't have time to make notes. I've been winging it all night.
We're bad at our job. That's what we're saying.
Yep. Sorry, guys. I blame it on coronavirus. God damn it. So you play the game as a squirrel. You have the ability to basically run around, grab the nuts that will, they kind of just appear. They like fall out of the sky. There are nuts. Your goal is to save the nuts. You want to get the nuts and put them in your hidey hole. For example, it's different on different maps, but for example, on one, it's like a doghouse.
Yeah.
So you have a doghouse that's orange on one side. You got a doghouse that's blue on the other. Classic, you know, orange v. blue. Get your nuts. Get them in your doghouse where they're safe. Whoever gets five first wins. Second game mode is battle. Where you get to fight it out a little more. And then the last one is like the first one, but the other team can steal your nuts. They're not ever safe. You have to get all five at one time without the other team stealing your nuts. I was a little surprised that at its price point, there were only three game modes to play.
Yeah, I'll give them credit for having online, though, in an indie game.
That's where I was going to say, on the plus side, there is online. And I would not have expected a game like Save Your Nuts to have online. I just wouldn't have. So kudos for that. But it does only have the three game modes. There are quite a few maps. But if you're playing alone, then it runs its welcome out very quickly.
Yeah.
There's just not enough to keep your attention on it. You can get different boosts. I got an achievement once for scoring a nut while riding in a jetpack. I mean, it gets insane, but also it's just, if you're alone, you're like, okay, but it's not funny. Yeah. when you throw other people in, that's when it gets more interesting. When you're brawling with each other as squirrels. I dug up a cannon at one point because there are little X marks where you can dig up things. I was a little disappointed that, yeah, it respawns, but the X with the power-ups, it never moves. It's always just in one place every map. It would have been nice if it was like moving around the battlefield and giving you more reason to go different places rather than grab a nut, go to your hole, grab a nut, go to your hole.
No.
That sounds terrible out of context. grab a nut in your hole, grab a nut in your hole. My bad. you can't make a game and call it Save Your Nuts and not expect this kind of...
Yeah, really.
This kind of review. We're 12-year-olds on the inside.
We are. You're that old on the inside? I'm nowhere near that. I'm like 4 on the inside.
Yeah, but a 4-year-old wouldn't get the nut in the hole reference. You got at least... You're at least like... 8 these days.
Okay, I'm an 8-year-old on the inside, but I still shit myself. So I'm 8 on the inside, and then that 8-year-old is 3 on the inside.
Okay, then. I'll give you that one.
I will say, Save Your Nuts, it's as intense and crazy as it gets. I think it gets too crazy and too fast. It's too easy to get lost.
Yeah. I never, like, it tells you at the top, like, how many nuts are on each side. And that's all well and good, but you can't actually make out what's going on the actual battlefield most of the time. Like,
yeah, it's moving just around, so chaotic and like, so everywhere.
It's even when I was playing it alone, I would only play 2v2 because that was just the most I could keep up with.
No.
Anymore, and I'm just like, panic attack. There's too much shit going on. I'm old. I don't have reflexes for things like that.
No.
So.
Well, $15 on this one. What do you think?
In most cases, based on content, I would be like, it's a little harder to recommend that. But given that it has online, that does save it a little. So I am going to roll with a try it.
Yeah, I could agree with you on there. I think the online is the saving grace. If this was an offline only game at $15, it would get a deny it from me.
And just I because have of
how chaotic and crazy it is.
I have thrown deny it at games for only having 3 modes.
Yeah.
I've done it. So
but the online it saves it and it brings it up to a try it for me as well.
Yeah. Yep.
All right, next game is called Bears Can't Drift, developed and published by Strangely Named. It released March 27th on Xbox One for $11.99. Put your paw to the floor and power slide between the pines as you face off against up to 3 friends in multiplayer split screen, including 12 tracks spread across 3 worlds and 3 game modes with up to 11 computer-controlled opponents. Bears Can't Drift is a retro karting action with modern look and feel. Cole, what did you think of Bears Can't Drift?
So... I really liked the way that Bears Can't Drift set up its menu options. It's super kid-friendly. Didn't even dawn on me that a menu could be problematic for a lot of smaller kids. But the way that Bears Can't Drift is set up is that you literally just drive down the road if you want to play in easy mode. If you want to play a harder difficulty, you veer off to the left where it says, you know, easy and medium. But for kids that can't read, it also has icons to indicate. Granted, easy mode has a pacifier for a baby, and that might piss off some little kids who are like, I'm not baby. I gotta find the hard mode. But, you know, most littler kids probably don't mind. And then, of course, if you do want hard mode, you veer off to the right and go that way. Really neat way that it's set up. Also, you drive into a hub world, and that lets you choose which one of the worlds that you're going to play. Unfortunately, they are progression locked, though, and you need to at least beat the races in each one before you can go to the next. kind of knocks the wind out of your sails when you've got like a little kid who just wants to go and race. Like somebody's gonna have to go beat that shit for that kid first.
No.
And I was kind of surprised that given like how kid friendly it was in other ways, that they kind of just threw their hands up on that, on the making all the worlds locked. That said, the races, there are a ton of different tracks. They're really cute. Everything is suitable for adults too. It's not one of those kart racers where it's like say Race with Brian, where it's like, okay, it's cutesy, but adults are going to be like, blah.
Yeah.
Bears Can't Drift is, you know, it's cutesy. It's got a funny little, you know, cartoon aesthetic to it, but it's all ages friendly. You can sit down as an adult and play it just as much as you can sit down and give it to your kid and let them go through it. Excuse me. Lost my breath there for a second.
Proud of you.
Yeah, I have to breathe when I'm doing these reviews, believe it or not.
Don't. Breathing's for pussies.
Oxygen's for bitches. Are we reviewing a kid game here?
It's an all ages game.
I do have one major gripe about the racing.
Let's hear it.
For the most part, it's very standard kart racer. There are a lot of offshoots that you can take. It's kind of meant for you to forge your own path. Again, it's kid friendly. If they fuck up and go halfway to the moon, they're still going to end up at the finish line at some point. But there are arrows on the road that point the path you should be going. They're almost impossible to see in some of the levels. One level, for example, is kind of like the inside of a volcano. And for whatever reason, even though I know it was a kid-friendly game, my mind was like, why are we racing in hell? But it's the inside of a volcano, and because the arrows are like a yellowish color, when they go over the lava looking parts where it's orangish yellow, you're just gone. There were so many times where I was like, I'm on the path, where the fuck am I? And then before you know it, like, you've ran into an invisible wall and you can't go anywhere, and you're like, well, I guess I'm hitting restart. Thank goodness I was on easy mode as an adult and can just catch up and run everybody over and lap them two times, even though I fucked up nine. So
yeah, on easy, the game is really easy.
Yeah,
like they're not joking around. Easy is friggin' easy.
Which I think is good, though. Like I said,
yeah, it's good for kids.
I kept playing it. You know, though, number three was like, I don't need it on easy mode. I was like, okay, then show off. Granted, she plays Forza.
Yeah. Oh, there you go.
I'm like, she does not care if it's easy or hard. But she was rolling right through it. But if I had a younger child that wasn't as used to playing more hardcore racers, I think the easy mode would be a good difficulty for them.
Yeah.
But at least, you know, it's not easy or nothing. You have harder difficulties if you really want to challenge. I didn't want to challenge because I kept getting lost and and I couldn't find the arrows.
Yeah, some of the tracks, I like, we dealt with this in some other racing games where if you're going up a hill or something and the track is up over the hill, you can't see which direction the road is going.
Yeah.
So a lot of turns, you'll be driving straight at the wall and you'll be like, oh shit, last second, you have to decide left or right. There were a bunch of tracks where I would go left and the track goes right. I'm like, shit, I got to turn around.
Yeah. And that's a bit of a problem for me. I don't like anything that doesn't have clear navigation. Yeah. That is one of my biggest gripes in games all the time. I just want good navigation and making those lines brighter, giving you a little more of a visual. You could, oddly enough, set the camera with like how much. Wait a second. That's not true. I'm confusing that with totally reliable delivery service. They had that option. I was going to say that you could change your field of view, but you cannot. all the games are blending together this week. I didn't make any notes. I apologize.
Hey, it's a crazy couple of weeks for everyone, so I won't hold it against you.
Oh my gosh. But you could control, I think, how close the camera was. But even when it was further out, like, I didn't find it to be any more helpful. I was constantly just slamming into things I had no business slamming into. And that's my biggest gripe. Like, beyond that, I thought the game was a lot of fun. You know, I would like to have seen a kid-friendlier mode where, like, everything was just unlocked and they could just go and not have to go through winning everywhere in order to get to the next stage.
Yeah.
But that's a minor gripe. The navigation is a far bigger issue for me. But beyond that, I thought it was really solid.
Well, then $12, what do you think?
Yeah, $12 for a kart racer with this many levels. Yeah, I'm solid with it. Give it a buy it.
Nice. I bought it myself for $12. I was kind of interested in checking this one out. I love my kart racers, and I had a good time with it. So for $12, I'm not mad.
Well, since you did buy it, you can definitely give it a buy it for $12.
I agree.
Nice.
All right, next game is called Snaky Bus, developed by Stovetop and Stage Clear Studios, published by Digirati, released March 31st on PS4, April 2nd on the Switch, April 3rd on the Xbox One for $11.99. Snaky Bus is an absurd arcade driving game and frantic score-chasing experience where the biggest danger is yourself. Wind through city streets, pick up as many passengers as you can, and deliver them to their destination to increase your score and the length of your bus. Cole, what is Snaky Bus? Besides amazing.
Well, you've already made the decision for me, so how much was it again? For forever, how much it is? What do you give it?
12. Oh my god. I told you, like, I might have to call this one and delete it.
Yeah. You're a fan.
I am very much a fan of this one.
I think the thing with Snaky Bus is that it's one of those games where once you fuck up and you have to start over, you're like, well, shit, let me try it one more time.
Yes.
And then before you know it, you spent 917 days playing Snaky Bus.
It's so true.
I think it's a really interesting concept for starters. It's Snake, but 3D, and you're a bus, and you have to keep moving. Mm-hmm. It's kind of okay to hit stuff, which is a little bit different than Snake that I know and love, where you touch anything for a country mile and you're exploding.
Yeah.
You have the okay to smash into things, so long as you can kind of like luckily wiggle your way out of it or use
as long as you can keep moving.
Yeah, as long as you don't stay still for more than, you know, a split second, then you're good. There are a lot of obstacles. There are plenty of things to try and get you to hit it. Interestingly enough, doesn't matter if you hit yourself as long as you can keep moving. If you hit yourself and then just kind of keep rolling with it and eventually like hit an on-ramp somewhere, you're good. Just keep going. There will be little rectangles scattered everywhere, and there are passengers at those rectangles. The number of passengers you have is limited to how long your bus is. So you need to make deliveries wherever it will light up for you to go. Make the delivery, your bus gets a little longer. Keep going. Never fucking stop.
Ever.
Ever. Don't stop. It's one of those games that it's stupid simple in concept. Anybody could play it. Anybody can do well at it. You just have to be determined to sit there long enough to do it. There are a ton of different maps. I think that was one of the more interesting things about the game, was just how many different scenarios they could create to put a bus that snakes. One of the first ones you start off in is literally a dorm room.
Mm-hmm.
And you have little, like, Hot Wheels ramps all over the place, and you just got random people scattered everywhere, and you pick them up, drop them off, your bus gets bigger, you go around the toilet. I got my bus in some of the, excuse me, sir. in some really crazy predicaments. Like, there was one point where I had come off a ramp, I had jumped off of it to get to the toilet, and then snake around behind the toilet and back out and like up under where I had jumped. So I was crossing back under my bus and then curving back around this doorway and going back out into the main room. And I'm like, there's no reason that should have worked. But I did it, and I'm the sneaky bus queen. That's not true. I have a really low score on the leaderboard. Please don't go look. I'm very bad.
Have you done good on any stages?
No.
I kicked some serious ass on Seattle.
Really?
Like the night driving stage in town. The previous high score was like 153 or something, and I got 270.
Damn.
Yeah, I took a screenshot of that one.
That's impressive.
I was proud of that shit.
Yeah, I was just happy if I got enough points to unlock the next stage.
Yeah.
I was like, yay me.
Yeah, lots to unlock. You unlock stages, you unlock different buses, including Cluster Truck makes an appearance in this game.
That was great.
Hard as hell to control, though.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty much everything about the game is hard to control. Like, yeah, I said I made the tiny little loop around the toilet, and it's like there's literally like a cock hair that you can fit your bus through, and there mine went, and I'm still flabbergasted I could do it. Nothing else I did mattered because I got through that little hole.
Nice.
And I was like, I am the best. And then I immediately like died with 40 trains and 40 buses. And I was like, God damn it. The more buses that you unlock, the bigger your bus gets and the more people you can pick up. And then again, it's a never ending pattern, but that leads to more score, which unlocks more levels and other bonuses. So it's one of those games that's simple. But it'll keep you coming back to it. There's plenty to keep doing with it.
Yeah. I will say I was very impressed with the performance of the game. Even when I had a couple hundred train cars riding behind me, I didn't run into any kind of performance issues. It ran smooth. I would get some pop in every now and then. But aside from that, the bus cars, I keep calling them trains because it's basically a big ass train.
It looks like a train. Yeah.
But the bus, it holds up and it follows you and it grows. The only problem I could see is every now and then I would kind of be on my own tail and I would hit a drop off and new cars would start popping on the back of the train and it would just knock me out of the way.
Yeah.
But you just got to be on your toes with that. And I keep calling it a train. God damn it. Choo-choo.
Yeah, I think that's just one of the more difficult aspects of you're actually good at it. And you're doing well enough for that to be a problem. Whereas I was just randomly crashing into things because I kept going the route of what happens if I jump here? What happens if I go there?
Yeah.
And then, like, I was trying to break it. Yeah. You broke it out of skill. I was trying to break it just for sheer curiosity.
Yeah.
Which tends to be how I approach a game like Sneaky Bus.
I will say, I don't know if I'm going to get my 1,000 in this one. I like the last two achievements that I need are going to be for a train being or a bus being 300 cars and 420 cars. I made it to 299. And I wrecked.
Oh, no.
299, and the achievement is 300.
Did you cry? I would have cried.
No, I played again.
Oh. Seems legit.
Yeah, and then the only other suggestion I could make is move the jump button. The jump button is on the left bumper, and it is very unintuitive.
almost never found it.
I couldn't figure it out for the longest time. I'm like, what fucking button jumps? I never think to check left bumper because I never use left bumper.
Yeah.
Like, move that to a face button. Move it to right bumper if you have to. I
instinctively pressed A every time.
Yeah.
And I was like, nope, that's not it.
Yeah, so let us move the jump button, please.
That would be good.
But aside from that, $12, what do you say?
I give it a buy it. I think it's a lot of fun. It's one of those games that you can just kick back and mindlessly play.
Yes.
And right now, given everything that's going on, I think we need more of that.
Yeah. I agree. Awesome game. I'm going to be playing this one a lot more. I had a blast with it, and I absolutely recommend this one. Buy it.
Yay.
All right. Next game is Lost Artifacts Golden Island, developed by CreoBit, published by 8th Floor, released April 1st on Xbox One for $9.99. Claire and her team are in trouble again. The airplane flew into a terrible storm and crashed on an uninhabited island in the middle of the ocean. When they woke up, our heroes went in search of help. After wandering a while, Claire found a village of Atlanteans and offered to help them get their homeland back and to teach the wicked ruler of the underwater world a lesson. Oh, how is Lost Artifacts Golden Island?
So I have to put out a heads up first. In the last Lost Artifacts game that I reviewed, I had a problem with it because of some of the dialogue options, where the whole premise was that our little archaeologist Claire finds a native tribe, and first she has to basically be their savior, and then also the enemy type that you have to deal with is literally called a savage.
Yeah.
I'm happy to report that that is not part of the new one that I am about to review. They did not continue that path. This time, Claire has found herself landed on an island, and you have to help basically solve the mystery of Atlantis. So there's no issues with like referring to the local people as anything problematic. If you have ever played an 8th Floor strategy game, you already know what you're in for. You don't even need to listen to me about this. You already know if you like it or not. They're all identical. That's fine. For whatever reason, I fucking love them.
Being identical is not a bad thing. If it's not broke, don't fix it, right?
Right. It's one of those cases where it's like, I don't even give a fuck what the story is. I just want to blow through some of these levels as fast as I can, call it a day. For whatever reason, every fucking one of these games has 49 levels. Why not 50? The world will never know. There are 49. Doesn't matter how big they make the map. Doesn't matter how small they make the map. Doesn't matter how they place the path. There's 49 levels. Fucking get used to it. each level will basically have you set up with a hut and one worker. Sometimes you luck out and already get to start with two or three. That's a little more of a special circumstance. Doesn't happen often. Don't get used to it. You usually have one. And then you'll need to collect resources. You need to collect wood. You need to collect metal. You need to collect gold. You need to collect food. You ain't doing jack shit if you ain't got food. So, fucking Ian making fun of me in chat. God damn it.
How they place them darn levels.
Yeah. Sometimes they go around the map. Sometimes they go like in a loop. Sometimes they just a little more straight. This time they go up and down like a hill. But with the level, you have your hut, have your workers, collect your resources, and then use your resources to build buildings. You'll need to build defenders who can stop the. You know, I don't think it ever said what the enemy type was called this time. They're purple, though. Anyway, your defenders will shoo away the troll things that come and try to take your resources that they decided not to name this go-around. your workers, of course, go collect your resources. Then you have mages as well that you can build. Then they'll do things like activate statues and such. One thing that I did notice, and I think this is because of the nature of these games basically being like carbon copies of each other, there were portals that in some levels would be called Atlantean, and in other levels would be called Aztec portals, like they were in the last game. I don't think they were meant to be called Aztec portals. I think somebody just didn't override that.
They forgot to update the name.
Honest mistake. But it was kind of funny. Didn't bother me once I figured out what was going on. In these games, you're just clicking because you already know what you need to do anyway if you've played it before.
Yeah.
And it's just like, okay, well, it's the portal, obviously. Click the portal. Doesn't matter what it's called. I was happy with it. I enjoyed my time with it. It's an easy 1K. Not necessarily short. You will need 2 or 3 hours to go through all of them. I mean, there's 49 levels. In order to get to completion, though, you need to get 3 stars on every level. And in order to do that, you have to complete the level before the timer bar on the left drains down to the first star. So once it hits the star blinks a couple times, goes away, and then you're down to 2 stars and 1 star. You can still beat the game and get no stars, beat the level. That's not going to get you any achievements, though, so you better get your shit together. That's what we're all here for anyway. I will say that I thought it was funny how when a girl says, I think it's funny how, it's not funny. I thought it was funny how I had a harder time getting 3 stars on some of the earlier levels than I did at the end. There's 2 reasons for why this happens, though. As you get further in the game, there are power-ups that unlock. One makes your workers move faster. The other one makes them work with buildings more quickly. And then the other one just freezes time. So in the later levels, you have these power-ups, but in the earlier ones, you do not. And the time just moves so fucking at the same fucking speed, regardless of whether you're on level 49 or on level 1. And it was like, they didn't seem to have the variation in how long it took you to beat it based on difficulty. It was like, nah, if you get it, you get it. Great. If you don't, well, sucks to be you. So that made the earlier ones more difficult than the later ones. And it was kind of weird, but you can go back and replay them. So it's not like it stops you from getting the achievement. It just means you have to go put a little extra time into actually getting those 3 stars. Oh,
boo-hoo.
Oh, it's so unfortunate. Look, I am the queen of these games because I play them so fucking much that I would literally finish like level 35 and only have maybe a quarter of my time bar gone.
Jesus.
And I'm like, well, I know what I'm doing and I'm done. So when I was struggling, the worst part was on one of the levels. I want to say it was like 14 or something. It was early. It was stupid early. Should have been able to knock it out really quick. But it got to where the worker was doing the last, hitting the last damn nail. And it was on 1 second on his timer. And it hit the star on the meter on the left. And I thought, I got a couple blinks. That 1 second's going to go away before that blink is up.
Nope.
And they ended at the same time. I got 2 stars.
Proud of you.
And had to do it again.
Proud
and
of
I
you.
Was like, I have never been so mad in my life. I just want to salt and burn the earth right now.
Oh, Lord. Well, it sounds like fans of the Lost Artifacts games have a lot to look forward to in this one. So for $10, what's your verdict?
I give it a buy it. I think if you already played them before, you already know. It's like an Artifix Monday game. You're like, yeah, I know what I'm getting, but I'm okay with that. Sometimes you just need something to kick back, put your feet up, and blow through without thinking about.
Yeah. And you already beat Snakey Bus, so play this instead.
This is a good break from Snakey Bus.
So you can just switch back and forth.
Yeah, when Snakey Bus becomes too difficult and kicks your ass, Lost Artifacts is there to be like, you know, you just got to point and click.
When you get that $2.99 in Snakey Bus, instead of throwing a controller, just pick up Lost Artifacts instead.
Yep.
All right. One final game to talk about tonight is called Duck Souls Plus, developed by Green Dinosaur Games, published by Rattalaika Games. Released March 24th on PS4 and Vita, 25th on Xbox One, 27th on the Switch for $4.99. Duck Souls Plus is a fast-paced action platformer about a little duck with an incredible skill to dash and a mission. Find all the eggs to save his species. Our friend Surly Not Covered this one, wrote in her review, this is what she's got to say. Hey there, SML friends and fans, it's Serlina, and this week I'm reviewing Duck Souls Plus for the PS4 and Vita. Duck Souls Plus is developed by Green Dinosaur Games and published by Rattalaika Games, who seem to be a favorite of the podcast. And in this action platforming game, you play as a cute little duck who must navigate challenges in order to save the remaining duck eggs and save his species from extinction. Let's get started with the review. The gameplay is fairly minimal. You're a cute yellow duck. Why can't I talk? You can jump, but you can't fly. Instead, you can dash. You can also wall slide. You have to use all of these and some of your own smarts to navigate through the levels and get them eggs. I found the game to be a tad bit on the hard side. There is a timer, but I honestly don't think it does anything except to increase your feeling of urgency because the timer doesn't reset as you go through the levels. The game does also keep track of how many times you die, but again, it doesn't seem to do much but make you feel like a failure. Yay! There's a bit of a saving grace. There's a checkpoint system, so when you die, and you will die several times, if you've hit the checkpoint, you can start from there and not at the beginning. Not every level has a checkpoint, and some have multiple ones, so bear that in mind as you play through the game. The game will also keep you busy for a while, as it has a ridiculous 100 levels. Let me be the first to warn you, this game is hard. The first few levels are easy enough, but after that, the kid gloves come right off. I won't lie to you, I couldn't get past level 18. I knew what I had to do, and I knew how to do it, but executing it just was a nightmare. I got to the point where if I didn't stop, I was going to break something, so yeah. The visuals are quite retro. It's all pixels and polys, not necessarily pleasing to the eye, but it certainly brings on the nostalgia factor. The levels are decently diverse and challenging, so you won't get bored, though I wouldn't be mad at you if you wanted to chuck a controller or two. I found the controls to be quite responsive, but still a bit annoying. Your cute yellow duck has a slight slide, most notable when you're landing from a jump, and that's annoying, so you have to be precise, otherwise you're starting over. I really enjoyed the music in the game. It's happy, quirky, and completely belies the fact that you are playing a monster of a game. Dare I say, the music lulls you into a sense of false security and hope. I rather like that. I also like that as you gain achievements in the game, you get little hats that you could put on your cute little duck. I do enjoy a snappy dresser. Duck Souls Plus is available on PS4, Vita, Xbox One, and Switch for $4.99, and should you buy it? Yeah, you should buy this one. I had fun with it, even though I lacked the ability to finish it. Besides, we're locked down. What else are you going to do with your time? That's nice. A good review.
Yeah. So I do.
You ain't got shit else to do.
I'm gonna pat myself on the back here. She made it to 14. I made it to 90.
Ooh, she made it to 18.
Yeah. I made it to 90.
Nice. So what did you think of the game? Did you want to chime in anything?
I had a really good time with it, but it was super hard. I wasn't expecting it to be that difficult. I was trying to actually remember what 18 was because the game gets insanely convoluted. You eventually reach a part where you are going through portals and you have to time like, okay, I have to time when I go through the blue portal so that I don't get hit by a blade while I pop out on the orange portal. I got to make sure that I'm not going to be hit by a bullet or something when I come out. The game does not play around with difficulty, and I was super impressed I made it as far as I did. I think I've got three achievements left, two for hats and one for finding the Easter egg. Mm-hmm. And I've got so far in the game that it flat out told me which level the Easter egg was in. It was like, hey bitch, you missed it.
Nice.
15 levels ago. Fuck. Yeah.
Oh, my God. Well, what are your thoughts for $5?
$5, I think it's a really solid platformer. I had a lot of fun with it. May not be one of the easiest Rattalaika completions, but it's probably one of the more enjoyable ones as far as a platformer goes.
Nice.
Yeah. So I'm good with a buy it.
Cool beans. All right. That is it for this episode.
We made it. We lived.
We made it. We did it. Hooray. Yay. Good stuff. Thanks to Kris for being here. Always good having him here hanging out with us. I was so happy when I was able to drop off that Switch to him.
I bet.
Like that I don't care how he felt. That made my day.
Yeah. That's one of those things. Like, you feel better doing something for somebody else. Even if he was I'm like him. I get uncomfortable when somebody gives me something. And then I'm just like, I don't know how to react to this.
Yeah.
So I can understand that. But I like to give shit to people, even if I know it's going to make them horribly uncomfortable, mm-hmm. because it makes me feel good. And I'm out here for me.
Yeah, I was really happy with how well that came together. Within like an hour, it was fully funded and we had the game donated.
What color did you get him?
We got him the gray one.
Ah, bummer.
Well, it was between blue and gray, and I know his favorite color is black.
Ah, okay.
So gray was the right one.
I can see.
If they had the pink one, I would have went with that though. But that one's not out yet.
Oh, yeah. Well, it wasn't out yet. Number one wants the pink one.
Yeah. So big shout out to everyone who chipped in to help Kris with that. I'm not sure if any of you are listening, but if you are, thank you again for chipping in.
That's a nice thing.
I'm just glad that Kris got a Switch and he got Animal Crossing and it cheered him up. That's all I cared about. I hate seeing friends who are down and who are upset, and, you know, putting a smile on someone's face puts a smile on mine. Yes. So I'm a selfish asshole. I just want to smile. Next fundraiser, we're going to save up our pennies and get Kris Taylor an Xbox.
Yes.
Yeah, Ian, we're talking about Kris Huber. We a bunch of us all chipped in and we bought him a Switch Lite,
mm-hmm.
and Animal Crossing. So that was fun to do. But
we need
to
give him like a $5 or $10 e-gift shop card so that he can go make use of the 9-cent sale.
Someone else asked if there was any more that needed to be donated. I'm like, just buy Kris a gift card if you want.
Yeah.
Chip in if whatever way you want. So yep. But yeah, that is it for this episode. Thanks again, Kris, for being here. Thank you for being here. Thank everyone in the audience for being here, hanging out with us, keeping us company.
Thank you for being here, Joe. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. I don't have anything else to do.
Me neither.
My life sucks.
I wouldn't go that far. Mine's fine, but...
Okay, yours is fine. Mine sucks. Do you have any final words to end the show?
No, we should have ended it at mine sucks.